Let's get into the book of Hebrews. I pray that the Lord has, in this time, done by his spirit within, a reigniting as to this book of Hebrews and the message that God would bring to us now as well from the book of Hebrews and all that it is saying and its beauty. And so I'm asking, Lord, tonight, this final time publicly here to in this group to present again this masterpiece letter, that, Lord, you would speak to my heart. Have you considered Christ as presented in the book of Hebrews? I say yes to you in that, Lord. Holy Spirit, take this book, this letter, Hebrews, and make Jesus Christ real inwardly to me, to us, your people, as far as you can and desire to take it, Lord, and are allowed to take it. Take this book of Hebrews, the message that you inspired, Holy Spirit, from the apostle. Take this message. Use it unto your glory, unto preparation, unto readiness, in its warnings and its encouragement for all your people worldwide who may come to encounter, Lord, not just through these messages, but just by your spirit speaking, working, we ask. So again, the sequence, I thought it was beautiful this morning when Josiah was sharing out of Corinthians. Again, you see the apostles' sequence in Corinthians from soul and spirit versus spirit, soul versus spirit, and then moving forward, just like here in the book of Hebrews. It's a testimony to who wrote both letters, despite what people say. I've said this many times. For the first 1,200 years of Christianity, they knew that Paul wrote Hebrews. I've met Paul several times. He said he wrote it. I believe him. I don't know what you think about that statement. If you think he's in the grave dead, you're dead wrong. You're the one that's dead, not him. I mean dead wrong. That's what I meant, Todd, dead wrong. You know what I'm saying? That's not using that as a trump card. I'm just saying that modernism has tried to take so many things away and devalue it in the taking. So, yes, it was not one of the disciples who wrote the book. We know that from the testimony of the book itself. Actually makes that very clear. Where does it make it that very clear? Well, in the book of Hebrews, it talks about having received the message from others. So we know then that it's, I know what it is. It's Paul, again, but specifically to the Hebrews. He's very qualified to talk to the Hebrews, he being one of them. And I knew the Old Testament extraordinarily well, but that's not all the reasons as to why we know he wrote it. But so what I want to do then is look sequentially in this last little bit here, sequentially at the book and come to its end as though Paul is bringing conclusions to us, reminders to us what we should be inwardly, what should be happening as to the mind, the will of God, the heart of God, the thought of God, all bound up to Christ. Now, so that'll, you know, maybe that's a little obscure what I'm saying, but hopefully we'll be made more real as we go. So in chapter 3 of the book of Hebrews, again, you don't have to turn. I'm going to do a little scanning of the book of Hebrews again. In chapter 3, coming towards the end of Hebrews chapter 3, come into verse 16. For who heard and rebelled? Wasn't it all who came out of Egypt under Moses? I want to just present to us something. You guys know this, like I know this. This is not a random statement. It's a sequential statement. He is laying out, the apostle is, what went on then as is happening now. I'm saying in his now, in the apostles now, with the Hebrews. It is a part of his warning and his encouragement. For who heard and rebelled? Wasn't it all who came out of Egypt under Moses? Do you see his point? There's those who have come into Christ. That's his point as we forget about the chapters and move forward. There are those who have come into Christ. And like Israel, this is his point. They rebelled. How did they rebel? They wanted to go back. Where? Egypt. What about the believers? Judaism. That's what Paul's saying. With whom was God angry for 40 years? That's a startling statement. I don't want God angry at me for 40 years. Remember one time when the Lord told me, he said, I'm slow to anger. I'm equally slow getting out of it when there's no repentance. And I'm like, I'm thinking to myself when he said that, I thought, what? Never heard that before. And then he quoted this passage, angry with Israel for 40 years. 40 years because of their rebellion. They wouldn't repent. And when they did repent, it was too late. They weren't going to enter in. I do not want that to be me. That's the point of this book. Let it not be. Let us go on. Let it not be us that makes the same mistakes. Let us go on. Right? So it's a very positive message about negatively what can happen. But don't let it. That's the encouragement of it, right? So in presenting this book, it's going to come across with that element in it. It's going to come across in its negativity, but it's a positive negativity in that it's the encouragement of God is let us go on. Let us not make the same mistakes. Paul was pointing out, do you envy that with him? As he did to so many of the churches, pointing out, warning, confronting. That's not to be envied, but it's necessary, and he had to, and he did, and he becomes, along with the Holy Spirit, the great contender for Christ. Right? I mean, when you say, well, yeah, Jesus, that's not what I'm saying. I'm saying that Paul became the great contender, not pretender, the great contender for what God wanted in Christ. He was fighting that good fight. Are we in that good fight? You want to be in that good fight? I'm going to tell you. If we mean that and the time we're in and we're moving forward into the shaking, but with the shaking, guys, and I want to hit this specifically right now, with the shaking is also in the house of God a great testing. The house of God is not only going to be shaken, but the people of God that are his people are going to be tested by that shaking as they watch people fall away, or it's worse than that, apostatize themselves because they lose their soulish things. Did you hear what I've just said? I'm warning us, for whatever you count me to be, whatever, doesn't really matter. I'm Terry. That's who I am. I'm warning us as I have to warn us. And I'm not a monotone type of guy. Aren't you glad? I mean, some of you fall asleep anyway, and I'm not even monotone. I'm at least I can laugh about it. I mean, I don't blame you for falling asleep. I don't get much sleep either. Maybe one day I'll be able to fall asleep in my own sermon. Wouldn't that be great, Wayne? Thunk. Like those cows at night that are standing up, and people go out into the fields and push them over, plunk, over there, whatever, they got a name for that. I've never done it. I've only heard about it. Don't own any cows. All right, now back to my point. So I have to say to us, guys, the shaking is going to shake the soulish dynamics in us. That church. You understand what I'm saying now? If we've been thinking all along that I'm saying just these things, well, that's but a symptom. A symptom, right, son? It's a symptom of what's in me. And that's my concern, is it not yours? It's my right concern for my own heart. Can I be shaken by the Lord? Think with me for a moment. If I can't let go, then God's going to shake me and make me let go. Because he loves me. It's not a punishment, it's an act of love. So we said something a moment ago, pretty much unanimous. We want to be with him in this. We want to be able, like Paul, to contend, to fight for what God wants. It's not just being against something, generally speaking. It's what God wants is the plumb line. The angel, I wasn't going to even tell you this, when the angel appeared last night, that watchman angel looked right at me. And the hands of Zerubbabel pointing right at me. Quoting Zechariah to me. There's other stuff that went on. What's that about? It's about hold the line. Distinction between soul and spirit. That's not my first rodeo for him to say that to me. It's been said many times to me, just not by him. Sword that was in our midst was the dividing sword of soul and spirit, right in our midst of the gathering. Let us pass the test. So not only is there shaking, but there's a testing that's coming upon the people of God that are going on. To not hear me. Don't let now be in time not to pay attention. Hear what I'm about to say carefully. If you can be discouraged because people decide when their soulish things are gone to fall away, you too will fall away. That's the warning of Hebrews. But maybe it doesn't seem real right now. It's going to become way more real, Chris. And if pity is what we move out of, human compassion, we're in trouble. Well, the Lord's in our midst after that statement to encourage us, don't get your eyes off of Jesus and on to others, not any others. So let me finish the scripture. Wasn't it that he was angry at? Who was he angry at? 40 years. It wasn't it those who sinned, whose bodies fell in the wilderness? See, they refused to enter in. See the warning? Out of our souls into Christ. Can you see the warning of that? It's beautiful to come out of Egypt, but that's not all there is to it. You cross the Red Sea, you've come out, but you can still be a slave in your inward man and in your thinking. They were. They're crying to go back to Egypt. Remember? Go back. Go back. We had provision back there. We knew where, listen, we knew where our provision was coming from in Egypt. Security was there. Even though there were, but you're slaves. See the soul? Can you hear the soul in that? The soul wants security. I'm upset because we're all not going there. Not me. I have a whole Bible history to tell me to not get my panties in a wad, and I don't wear them. Because, what do you think about that, Alan? That was the Greek for not getting your panties in a wad. I'm trying to help us ahead of time. It's begun, but it's only going to become more and more test. Hear that word, I keep saying it, a test. We are going to be tested. And if we are thinking it's just whatever, ethereal testing, it's going to be extraordinarily practical in how we're going to be tested. Not everyone who came out of Egypt, we remember, entered into Canaan. In fact, no one did, except for two people. Once a slave to your soul, always a slave to your soul. I'll give you the mic, let you come up here and say it. If we're going to judge, once a slave to the soul, always a slave to the soul, unless we let the Lord open our eyes, spiritually speaking. Open our hearts, spiritually speaking. Open our ears, spiritually speaking. Quit arguing. Quit letting the soul argue. Quit letting the soul come to reasoning, human pity, and realize what the Lord is attempting to do. How many would agree with me? I don't want to see a show of hands. I'm just saying this. How many would agree to me? We need the Lord to be able to do his work. And it can be a quick work if I won't resist, hold on to my soul and what I like. So back to Hebrews 3. Lord, help me. I'm saying this about my own heart. Help me. Help me. It can be a quick work, and I'm not just talking individually. I'm talking about corporately, and not just with the gathering, but whoever's listening, wherever the Lord. This is the book of Hebrews, and the burden of the Lord upon the apostle, the inspiration of the Holy Spirit right in this masterpiece letter called the book of Hebrews. This warning, I would fail the Lord miserably. You won't, I will. But I would fail the Lord miserably if I do not hammer, and I have one, home this point. And I don't have it because it's a potted plant to look pretty. It was not given to me for that purpose. Just to be real with you. So let me hammer home something to us. You, me. Can you hear that? Are going to be tested. It's easy to say, I want the Lord. The testing will prove it. Well, the Lord said it was a good message, no matter what you guys think about it. Thank you. All right, so to whom did he swear that they would not enter? His rest. I don't have to tell you guys. Read 2 Thessalonians. God gives them over to a deluding spirit because they believe the lie. It's the same message right here. The same author. the Spirit of God, and the same apostle. Yes, I'm Terry saying this. But it ain't just Terry saying this. I'm arguing with some people in their minds right now. Sorry. We got some stinking thinking going on here. Really bad. I know I don't usually do this. This is unusual, isn't it? But I'm addressing this way because, guys, you think it's not you. You think I'd be wrong to think it's not me. God's talking, trying to break through, and our soul's resisting. We'd rather be right than humble ourselves. He swore they'd not enter his rest. Now let me say this as we head forward. Notice then over these next few passages, forget chapter 4, we'll just go right on, Sam, you know, because there's no chapters. Not enter his rest, it becomes a key word. There's key words in the book of Hebrews, and these next, what we call chapter 3 and 4, are critical to the understanding of the entire book. Like what Josiah was hitting today with the Corinthians. What was critical to the understanding of what the apostle was after and what would follow in the rest of the letter? Well, in Hebrews, it's here in chapter 3 and 4. Would not enter his rest. Not enter his rest. The soul is restless, right? The soul is restless. The soul can't be satisfied without the outward things. Can you hear that from the Lord? It's the soul that's not satisfied except with outward things. One more time. It is the soul that needs the outward things, craves the outward things of Christianity, of church life. It's the soul that needs it. It cannot be satisfied without it. And it makes up doctrines so that it can justify its rebellion, that there's one source of Christ and he's joined to the human spirit, conquering the soul, not destroying it, but the soul needs saving. The goal of our faith, Peter said, is the salvation of our souls. It's deliverance. So I'm not just talking to the gathering tonight. I am, but I'm talking to whoever's listening. He that has ears to listen, listen. There is preparation in this, greater preparation. May God, I know this to be a fact, may it is the will of God, it always is, but it is particular to our times. It is the will of God, my friends, to speak to us. Preparation and readiness of which we want and are crying out for, right? Hello? Well, it's got to be better than that. Do we want readiness? Yes. We're not going to arrive there by placating our own souls or anybody else's. Did you hear what I just said? And the fruit of kindness needs to be coupled with truth, or human compassion will keep us in the same place. You know that? And to whom did he swear? You will not enter my rest, if not to those who disobeyed. So we see that they were unable to enter because of unbelief. Therefore, since the promise is to enter his rest, or to enter his rest remains, let us beware. There it is again, huh? That none of you be found to have fallen short of what? Entering his rest. Letting your soul be dealt with by God so that you're not restless when we don't get the outward things. Been saying this for how many years? You've been hearing me. We've talked about it. I know you believe it. This is already happening in other parts of the world. They don't have anything of what we have right now. When they meet, it's in secret. And if their satisfaction is in what we think is needed, they are in trouble. What's wrong with the picture? Our souls thinking. And the lack of the mind of Christ. The mind of Christ, that's a loaded statement, not a simple one. The mind of Christ. Let this mind be in you, which was also in Christ Jesus. That's the God, let's say it this way, God in his wisdom, God in his purpose, God in his plan, God in his thought, his full intent. That's the mind of Christ. A small portion of it, I'm just hitting it. That's what's being said. It isn't some little small thing being said. Oh yeah, Jesus. Wow. That's an open door to chaos. And you see what's going on here, and it'll come in later, but let me jump ahead real quick and then we'll get to it. Where's their faith? What we call Hebrews 11. Where is it? Because if you're thinking about going back, if you're concentrating on what you don't have because your soul wants something, now my soul wants something, and without it, I can't go on in the Lord. I'm missing something. I got to have it. See? Beware. That none of you be found to have fallen short. Not entering rest. See? There's a rest of Jesus Christ in our inward man to where we're not in need. How many believe that? How many believe Matthew chapter 6? Take no thought for your life. Your heavenly Father knows what you have need of before you even ask. But you seek first the kingdom of God. That's an inward kingdom. And all the rest of this stuff, don't make it your focus, will be added to you. How many believe that? Is that not a radical statement? Christianity, in that way, is radical from the earth's thinking and from the earth's desires and from what all that goes on with. Those are what the unbelievers crave and seek after and work hard for to obtain. But our Heavenly Father knows what we have need. I'm not saying, and please don't quit your job. But if your job quits you, your source is not gone anywhere. It's Christ. Amen. He can give you another job, but if he's teaching us about source and trust, learn the lesson, because it's going to come back around, right? For we have also have received the good news just as they did. See what's going on? But the message they heard did not benefit them. I hope that what I'm sharing tonight, what Josiah shared this morning, what I shared Saturday night, what Josiah shared Saturday morning, what I shared Friday night, is a benefit. And not in our souls and out just as quick. Because if that's all it is coming into the soul, that's exactly what will happen. Just another message. Did not benefit them since they were not united with those who heard it in faith. There's some who heard the message and it didn't go into their souls. It wasn't their souls overriding it. The faith of Christ was working. And they were trusting in the Lord. That's true of Caleb. It's true of Joshua. For we who have believed enter the rest. And can you see what's going on here? The apostle is laying out the issue of rest early in this letter. Rest from what? Our souls. But Christ being our rest. That's what he's saying. It's a spiritual rest, and your soul's not spiritual. You have a spirit, but the soul, I've said this the other night, your soul was created relationally for what's out here. But God lives united to your spirit. It's a union of spirit that God has, not our soul. God is not united to our soul. He's conquering it. He gave it to us, and he's not destroying it. Conquered, the soul is a beautiful tool through which the Lord can relate himself to the outward world. Unconquered, we're going to be restless in our souls. And let me say this to you. How do we invite sinners to come to Christ and find rest when we're living from our souls? And I'm looking at it corporately. What are we bringing them into? A religion that's going to make their soul be glorified? Now they've got religious desires in their soul? You think that's helpful? That's what's going on. And you see it. How many have seen it? I don't look for a show of hands. How many have seen this in activity? Well, God didn't do what he said he was going to do. God didn't do for me what I wanted him to do for me. And people get angry and they fall away quickly. Others, after years and years and years, you know, God's not doing anything for me. I don't want to be around him. I don't care for him. I don't even know if he exists anymore. That's the soul in what we call the church, laying the foundation of religious soul in born again, maybe born again people, if they've been born again. And so the church becomes the greatest enemy, rival to Jesus Christ. I've said it and I'll say it again. Just as certainly as Satan took hold of Judaism when God had brought his son into the world, and it's the death, the end of that former covenant that was pointing to the eternal covenant. And yet Satan, because of the soul, right here in Hebrews, Paul's addressing it, because of the soul loving the former things, even though they had tasted, this is going on into the book of Hebrews chapter 6, even though they had tasted the things of God, their soul had not come to rest. That's the point of the apostle. And when the soul is not come to rest, then the soul is restless. Even though you've tasted the goodness of the Lord, even though you've experienced the powers to come, Hebrews 6. And though that be true, you will fall away because you're not getting what your soul demands, and your soul's voice is speaking the loudest. Is that helpful? You know, I could murmur that, but I don't know that that would help you, but I'm just saying there's ways maybe to deliver that differently, but I'm trying to be very, very, very clear. I need to be clear. I must be clear. I want to be clear. God, help me to be clear. But that's the sequence that Paul's addressing. No rest, you're going to fall away. Particularly now with the great shaking and the great testing. What all types of tests are we going to face? It's overarching, I can say this to you, where the soul will not have what it wants, but you can forever have Christ within. And he can rule over the soul. He certainly wants to. Isn't that true? There's the encouragement. Now, I can't give a false encouragement here, nor a false hope. It's Jesus. He's the right encouragement, and he's the right hope. Right? So we're looking at a little bit latter part of chapter 3, then coming on to chapter 4. So... Therefore, let's skip down here a little bit. Therefore, verse 6, since it remains for some to enter it, And those who formerly received the good news did not enter. Notice that statement. They received the good news, but they did not enter. One more time, they received the good news, but they did not enter. There's the soul at work. What if our salvation is soulish instead of Christ as new life? What if our salvation is soulish instead of a spiritual new birth? What if, since we all here came into a system, that for the most part was birthed soulishly? What if? This isn't far-fetched. What if? Because of that, and the teaching that came out of that, the direction that came out of that, we're deceived. I'm deceived. Listen, please forgive me if I don't placate the soul. I shouldn't need, don't you think, to say to my own heart, comfort, be comforted, soul, when the Lord is waging war against it. He's trying to conquer it. It is not helpful for me to want comfort for my soul when the Lord, from every direction, including other people, are you with me, you who are married? You who have children. You who are at work. The Lord's using all types of venues to wage war against our souls unto the salvation, though, of the soul. It is redemptive in its purpose, but if we comfort the soul wrongly, the soul's a survivor, and the soul, religious soul particularly, and the soul is very religious but hates the cross and doesn't like this message I'm preaching either. Man, I don't like what you're saying. Refer back to what I said right before I said that. The soul doesn't like this message. Of course it doesn't. Soul can be very, very religious amongst outward things. Can you hear that? Please hear what I'm about to say rightly. What if we've never been rewired to know what it is for the Lord to actually use our souls by coming through it? What if we've never seen it? Never been that possessed of the Lord? Never been under the control of the Spirit to that degree? Again, with willingness, the Lord can do a quick work. Quick, I don't mean in a one-moment thing. But I'm telling you, in 2 to 3 years, he can really take ground well. Right? I mean, at least one of the ites can be gotten out. Don't you think? But not if we're placating the soul, not if we're comforting our souls, not if the Lord is dealing with our brother or sister and we rush to comfort what God is attacking. What we're saying is, move aside, Holy Spirit. No, you can't do that. I don't think I need to tell God what he can and can't do. I think I need to see better than that, hear better than that, understand better than that. I don't need to tell you. Let's just admit it to each other. Admit it to ourselves first. God, this is not a great revelation. God is dealing with our souls. Of course he is. Do not think you're the only one. That's a lie of the enemy. Don't receive it that way. And everything is about how we receive even this message and what the Lord's doing. Receiving this message, if that's difficult, what are we going to do in the word when the Lord's working in us? If you think this message is difficult, what are you going to do when the Lord's really working? You know, that's the first time I've ever said anything like that. Thank you. It's according to the times we're in. But it's that way always, really, isn't it, Chris? Isn't it, Lee? It's always this way. This is nothing new. Maybe new to us, but it's not new. This has been going on for 2,000 years, guys. God the Spirit dealing with the soul, the human soul. 2,000 years, I'm saying, since Christ came and wants to take charge of the soul, the battle has intensified even over the top of what happened in the Old Testament. I'm saying this to you, the battles of the Old Testament don't hold a candle to what we're in the midst of. Satan was not arrayed back then against the people who were being inwardly possessed of the Lord. Now all guns are blazing. And we can't, please hear what I'm about to say. You can't meet the battles that we are presently in. Please hear me. I don't want to have to spell it all out, though I could. You're not going to be able, I'm not going to be able, we're not corporately going to be able to meet and see God defeat the principalities and powers that are arrayed against the Christ and Christ in a people, Christ possessing a people with Old Testament belief systems. It's not the same battles as back there. It is way worse and off the charts. And Satan can't be defeated like those weapons back there. He's defeated now by the measure of Christ in us. He's defeated by the measure of Christ in us corporately, individually. He is defeated by the possessing of the Lord of us. Because the Lord defeated him. That's why it's a measure of possession. It's a measure of Christ's life. It's a measure of the fruit of that life. The shutting of the doors is the life of Christ, an open door. And it shuts the door to the soul. Amen. We are stuck in our thinking and our concepts in the Old Testament, and what we have not, as the New Testament apostles and prophets did, brought Christ to those scriptures. They brought life to the scriptures, the 39 books of the Old Testament, the life of Christ. And they preached the life of Christ from those. We're just bringing them over and, oh yes, we got to do this, got to do this. And we're in mass confusion, thinking the principalities care. Please hear what I'm about to say. We think the principalities care about this thing we do. They laugh at us. They're as foolish as they look. I guess I could have said that better. They're stupid as they look. I'm not being mean. I'm really not. I'm trying to wake us up to reality. We need a new reality of Christ. I'm telling you, and I'm just telling you, I do know something about this, you know, about the battle and principalities. You read the book, The Angelic Order at War. Not a novice. Not a know-it-all in it either. I'm not a novice. I'm going to tell you, what upsets them is Christ as inward life coming into the people of God. Not what we do in a meeting. They are not defeated in any meeting. There's a reason to be gathered. Hebrews 10 is what we're talking about. There's a real reason to assemble ourselves. by the way. Real reason. But it's not the reason we've had. And it's not an Old Testament reason. Something should be going on when we do come together that counts inwardly as pertains to Christ's life. And if Christ's life is, and that's just a, I'm talking corporate, guys, it's got to be more so, because how often are we together like this compared to the rest of our time? So what's got to be going on is this, the Lord within taking ground, possessing me, right? Possessing me, taking out the ites by possessing me. He possesses and drives out the ites. Let me ask us all a question. Wake up call. How many of us, in all our years of Christianity, if that is true with us, ever heard good teaching, good speaking, preaching concerning soul and spirit? How many? I want to see your hands. And we think what we're doing in the church is good when that's the case. I tell you, the soul is all in the church and we can't see it. The Lord told me to say that, by the way. That wasn't my own thought. He said it to me earlier. Can you see where we've come to? And thus why evil is allowed to arise at such a great pace in our time, and that in the church. Why is marriage so broken? Why are marriages ending in divorce so much? Why is the home so split apart? Why is there such failure in the leadership, whether it's of God or not, in what's called the church? Why is there such failure in the house of God? Why is there such immaturity in the house of God? Why is the soul so predominant in the house of God? When we just confessed, all of us here, by the lack of hands going up, that none of us, well, I can say maybe I missed somebody's hands. None of us had a proper release of the Spirit of God concerning Hebrews 4 and the dividing of soul and spirit. And yet we've started churches. I did. On what ground? On what basis? I can answer that right away, Wayne and Rebecca. The soul, that's what. Tradition, what I knew, what I understand. Right, Chris? He's with me, and just let's just face it for a second. Why does my soul want to flare up against what I'm saying? And why can't it be by the Spirit of God brought to a place of silence while God speaks? It is improper judgment to judge what's going on in this now moment with what's behind us. Yes, we were much happier back then. Our soul was getting what it wanted. Gina and Serena, y'all should have just not came at all. No, I'm playing with you. Y'all got good senses of humor, so y'all can take it. Mess it around. Wow, what did we walk into? The dividing of soul and spirit. We should have had it back then. Would have saved people who are now lost because we told them the wrong gospel, showed them the wrong gospel, made meetings our salvation. What are you saying, Terry? I'm speaking a revolution. His name is Jesus. Thank you, Bob. Yes. This system of Christianity, this system of church, is a tired, worn out thing. needing to be discarded as certain as Judaism. It is obsolete because of the soul. That's Paul's point in this epistle. It's where he ends up. Let us make every effort to enter that rest so that no one will fall into the same pattern of disobedience. Verse 11. Stunning, Sam? Stunning scripture. For the word of God, here's the distinction, is living, not traditional, not soulish. The word of God is living and effective. I'm saying it's what he's saying. It moves us to, I'm just using this word, sainthood. Saint meaning holy one, separated to God. You're separated to God by God, the Spirit. The word of God is living. Compared to the old covenant, compared to the former covenant, compared to that which was only a shadow, only a type, which was given because they would not believe in the Lord, given because of rebellion, given because of sin, that covenant was introduced. Enoch didn't need it. Abraham didn't need it. Seth and his son didn't need it. Men and women of God before the law didn't need the law because they had Jesus, and they believed the Genesis 3:15 promise of God to Adam and his wife. And they knew it, by the way. It was passed down. Before Moses wrote it, they knew it. Enoch knew, and they were separated to God, even as groups of people, they were separated. They had nothing to do with Cain and his clan. They lived separate from Cain until some of the sons from that godly line saw how pretty some of Cain's descendants' daughters were. And then that brought the flood. It always brings the flood. When the soul comes to that kind of power. And there's a rival as to way, truth, and life. That rival to Genesis 3:15. Satan's head will be crushed. The serpent's head will be crushed. It's interesting that he will crush the head of the serpent. It's a specific statement against the serpent, because the serpent tempted the woman in her soul. That's why it's used there. And it's the soul temptation that's come to the church and been bought into, added to. Oh, that adding, it's not a big deal, Terry. I disagree. It may not be a big deal if our hearts didn't gravitate towards the soul because of the first mother. But it does. Can we just be real, Chris? We've got to be real. We've got to be real with ourselves. I have to with myself. You have to with yourself. We gravitate towards the soul. And a message like this creams us. It's pointed right at Christ. And by Christ and our souls. God is in a wrestling match like what he did with Jacob, wrestling him over his soul. God's now in a wrestling match with us. I aim to stop fighting and let him win. I was thinking about the boat imagery. When they were in the boat and Jesus was asleep. What do you do in that time? You go to sleep. That's what you do. If he's sleeping, you sleep and rest. Trust him and rest. Just lay down in the boat. Scrunch over there, Jesus. Can I borrow your robe and use it for a pillow? That's what you do. Right? Stop fighting the waves. They're going to keep coming. They're focused on the waves. They were focused on everything but the Lord. And thus is the plight of the church. That's the nature of the soul. The soul is frantic. Can't you see what's going on with my finances? Matthew 6:33 seems so foreign. Seek first the kingdom of God. Don't quote that to me. That's the soul talking. Don't quote that to me. That doesn't mean anything. That's the soul. That's the franticness, the panic of the soul. I'm just using this as an illustration. The soul is that way. It reads God that way. God is God when my needs are being met. God is God when I'm getting what I want. God, here it is. God is among us when our souls can see. I beg to differ. Now, he may not be among us, but it's not because the soul can't see him. There is that which is the word of God that is living. Do you believe that? Because if you don't, your soul is going to lead you to disaster. In the time of shaking and in the time of testing that we are in, I hope that when they were in the ark, the animals and Noah, his wife, and all their family slept. Don't you? Despite the smells, despite all the noise, despite the complaints, and I'm talking about the human side of it. When are we getting out of here? Stop the rain. I've had enough. I'm going for a swim. Like Peter, bid me come unto you. Anything's better than this stupid boat I'm in. Just bid me. No, that's not what I'm just saying. When you're in a rocking boat, and even though you've been a fisherman, and it's that bad out on a storm, they've been in some, being a fisherman. Now, the other guys that weren't fishermen, several of them were, we know that, James and John, Andrew, Peter, they were fishermen. But not Matthew. He's a tax collector. Seasick, or the Sea of Galilee sick, was all over him, I would expect, don't you? I'm surprised Matthew didn't say, bid me come to you. I'm surprised all of them didn't say, bid me come to you. You got to have some relief. Right? So sleep, rest, enter his rest. And I'm not saying his rest is, it's an internal rest, but allows you to be at peace because he's the Prince of Peace from within. It allows you to sleep in the storm. How many believe that's even possible? You know he's trustworthy. Isn't he, Eugene? You've had some really difficult times, haven't you, brother? You've had loss in your family, your son. I know that. And other dynamics, others in this congregation. What's the difference maker in this? Is it not Jesus? It doesn't mean it's going to be easy, but you can be in inward peace and rest, right, Walter? Because of Jesus. Did you hear what I said? Because of Jesus. Not because the thing gets remedied. They're not coming back. They've gone on to be with the Lord. They're in the ark. We're the ones still in the little boat flopping around. All right, so let's go on, right? That's the injunction of the book of Hebrews. Let us go on. Let us not be those who never entered into his rest, that never allowed the Lord to bring our soul's life and power down by Christ, though, firstly, coming to full measure. Is that not the message? Let us go on. So then we look at a few other passages. I want to look at chapter 11 briefly. I mentioned it. Now, faith is the reality of what is hoped for. Verse 1, chapter 11. For the or hope for, and the proof of what is not seen. For by it, our ancestors, the godly ones, that is, won God's approval. This is not performance-based. It's a spiritual believing, trusting, and thus entrusting ourselves to the Lord Jesus Christ. Bear with me, guys. I know this may be a lot or whatever. I don't know. Just a real battle of our own souls and trying to keep our eyes and ears focused, our minds focused for a moment. But bear with me. Two things are going to happen. If the faith of the Son of God is not allowed to conquer our souls, the battle is going to be twofold. And being conquered by the Lord, and thus Him conquering through us in the battle, is contingent now upon that simple, but not of us, from the Spirit of God, from Christ living in us Himself, from what God the Father has absolutely promised in the giving of His Son. Can you hear the victory that I'm talking about? Maybe we've heard it so much we can't hear it rightly. That can't be the answer. It absolutely is. The answer can be so profoundly simple that the Lord is the answer. But the soul will never accept that answer and wants a better answer, a quicker solution. We will be paralyzed by the testing, the attacks coming against us corporately and individually. We will be paralyzed and petrified unless we believe Him. That He that begun a good work in us will bring it to completion. Let's start there. Unless we can believe and do believe that the Lord, this is so simple, isn't it, Sam? That the Lord did win the victory on His cross and in His resurrection from the dead. That the Lord obtained victory over all the power of the enemy, and all authority in heaven and earth has been given to the Lord. Our victory is in the Lord, secured. Secondly, and that's true of what He's done for us, what He has begun to do inwardly in us. No matter how far along that is yet, trust Him. Do not give in to fear. Do not give in to voices of questioning when you can't give them the right answer because they can't hear the right answer. It's like that football coach. You can't hear the truth. Whoever said that, you know. Well, you can't hear the right answer. Don't please hear the context in which I'm saying this. Don't argue with fools. A fool being defined as someone who doesn't believe, even if they are a believer, who believe in the Lord, that He who has begun a good work in us will complete it. I said this the other night, Saturday night. We're not going to understand everything. We're not going to be therefore able to explain everything. We don't need to trust Him. He is trustworthy. Is He not? We don't need to know it all to know Him. We just need to know Him. And to know all that is Him is an eternal matter. So there, people are going to argue with us, but you know, can you even say that to them? You may can, but whether they hear it or not, if they're in their soul, they're not going to hear it. And if they do hear it, it's probably going to just make them angry. Or they may be stupefied for a moment and then go on about their merry, soulish life. My friends, don't be petrified. Don't be paralyzed by the testing of our faith, the trying of our faith. Are you listening? That is more precious than gold to the Lord. It should be to my own heart. He's not wanting to say you'll be strong one day and then you'll be able to stand. No, he is the strength in our weakness. You can stand right now. Stand, right? Fight the good fight of faith and stand. Yes, family's coming against you. Friends are coming against you. Loved ones are coming against you. People who hate you are coming against you. And you don't have all the answers. You don't need all the answers. Christ is our sufficiency. Christ is our belief himself. It may not be for them. It don't have to be for them. They're not the ones being tested. I am. You are. Stand, people of God, stand and believe. And you will see, I'm talking about inwardly in us, the salvation of our God. You will. Is that not true? It's only going to grow worse as the world goes its path and the world of the church goes its path to where there is the testing is going to include what we're already seeing, the mixture as it did with Judaism, the mixture of Christianity, yes, but also. No, no, no. Jesus, yet, but also. See? Isn't that right, Chris? Yes, you can sit down if you want because I'm not even done. I'm not even thinking about quitting. Thank you. I thought about quitting, then I put that nasty thought right out of my mind. Why would I think about quitting when I'm encouraging us all not to quit? You're trusting God? Don't stop now. Trust him. Amen. What will come out of it? I don't care whether. Listen, here's what the soul's going to need to be brought into its place by the Holy Spirit within us. I don't care, soul. Just speak to your own soul. That's right out of Psalms. Be still, O my soul. That's speaking to your soul. I don't know if it'll listen or not. Do you, Mike? But if it doesn't or not, doesn't matter. Tell it anyway. Be still, O my soul. Shut up. That's really what's being said. Shut up. Your voice is so loud, but that's about to stop. Because the Lord's voice will rise above when I trust him. But not until I trust him. The soul's voice will be louder until we trust him in real time in the battle. Right, Rick? And when we trust him consistently, time after time after time, no matter whether our soul sees the result it wants. Do you understand what I'm saying? That the purpose I'm seeing is greater than the soul getting what it wants. I'm seeing something, isn't this right, Alan? Spiritual going on. Do people appreciate that, Alan? Have they? They don't, do they? Do your family argue with you? They won't be watching, right? So let's just tell me their names and I'll call them out. No, no, totally joking. What do you think about that, Kyle? Alan's telling me he just has to be quiet. But see, that's because his soul's been quieted, so he can be quiet. He doesn't feel the need to answer fools. Sorry. Again, a fool being a person who doesn't believe in the Lord, especially a believer, right? The truth is in this, is we can speak to our souls and consistently, the loudest voice to the soul is the voice of the Lord through us. Nevertheless, right out of Habakkuk, right? Go read it again. Read the ending there. Though all this is happening, yet I will trust in the Lord. I will glory in the God of my salvation. Right? It will seem so foolish to those, even in your family, even amongst your former friends or friends, if they abandon you usually, call you a nut, call you a kook, call you a part of a cult. Is it a cult to believe in Jesus? Sign me up. Good night. If we're preaching something other than Christ, maybe you understand the whole church is now a cult because of the loss of Christ. And so isn't it just like the soul to call the cult that which is believing in Christ? To call a cult that which denies the need for soulish things to satisfy, when the cult is the one who believes in soulish things that they do satisfy? The substitute for Christ, that's the cult. Is it not? If Josiah, Chris, and I are giving you something other than the person of Jesus Christ, we're a cult. But if we're giving you Jesus Christ, if we're preaching Christ and Him crucified, and that's absolutely what's going on, or we wouldn't be in the battle we're in, right? Then the soul is angry. And the church, under the control of the soul, is angry. Thank you, Lord. Again, affirmation. Good preaching, Terry. He's standing right there. Either it's his oracle or it's not, but it is. It's him, Christ himself. So we do not want to be paralyzed with fear, shrinking back into unbelief, by the way, not trusting him. That's how we shrink back. Because our soul is squirming, our soul is angry, our soul is screaming louder and louder and louder, I need this. Be still, O my soul. Trust in the Lord. Right? So, the ancients that's described here, all came right there to that point. And they passed the test into provenness. This form of provenness. They trust in me. It's easy to say, I trust in you, when you've not been through the multiple and multitude of battles that actually prove that God allows for the proving that we can trust him and will trust him, right? He's not trying to hurt us. He's trying to train us, but not our souls. Conquer our souls. He is not training our souls. He is saving them, conquering them. And while we are united to him in spirit, those who have joined themselves to the Lord are one spirit with him. That is not talking about the soul. Again, the soul's not done away with. We don't preach the annihilation of the soul. If only it were that easy. Right? No, the soul must be conquered. Therefore, it becomes, and it will be eternally, to the entire universe, the created universe. You understand what I'm saying? The soul relating to the entire universe, Christ, who is living, joined to our spirit and us to him. Well, so fight the good fight of faith and don't be petrified. Don't be confused by the questions, by the accusations. Don't be fearful. Do not be fearful of them. Trust in the Lord. Well, that's briefly chapter 11. Chapter 12, therefore, since we also have, I read this tonight, but have such a large cloud of witnesses surrounding us, let us lay aside every hindrance and the sin that so easily ensnares us. Again, the context of this is the soul. That's the sin that so easily entangles us. Are you listening? What is the sin that so easily entangles us? Giving in to our souls, yielding to our souls, making decisions from our souls, reasoning from our soul. That's the mind of the soul, right? and its emotions and its will. Right? Everybody knows mind, will, and emotions are there in the soul with the natural person. There's also the mind of Christ, the will of God, and God in control of our emotions. Right? And that's a fight, right? Don't placate it, recognize it. Don't excuse it, recognize it. It will dissipate as we recognize and say, okay, Lord, come in. Possess me. It doesn't. Please hear what I'm saying. The soulish things, individually and corporately, don't go away by not dealing with it. Hello? Have we learned that lesson? The church is notorious for this. Maybe it'll get better. Are we out of our minds? We need to be, and in the mind of Christ. It doesn't get better just because we're unwilling to deal with. Don't allow the Lord to deal with your own soul. It's not going to get better. And that's corporately true. Right? Hello? I'm not speaking to you as your friend Terry. I'm giving you the oracle of the Lord, and we need to listen. Soul does not get better undealt with. It comes into greater and greater possessing power. Let me finish at least a little bit in chapter 12 here. We're surrounded by these cloud of witnesses who learned the lesson that we're now speaking of. In their journeys, because of what they went through, they had to learn to trust in the Lord. And that they did. Abraham, to the point that he was not looking in this earth. Hear me. Now, this is the soul brought into subjection, don't you think, Chris? He knew that nothing in this world satisfied him. He was looking for another city that wasn't on this earth, whose builder and maker was God. Now that, Madeline, is the soul in check, don't you think? Abraham went there. Look at his journey. Can we take that journey? Can you go out, Sam, not knowing, and face those who think they know? Right, guys? Face those who think they know and want to tell you they know and correct you with what they know. But like Abraham, this is not foolishness if it's the real Jesus in us. Has he come in? He has. Are we at the beginning? Well, maybe, but he's begun that good work. Trust him. You can go out not knowing and find the Lord every time as he tells you to go. Go on. Let us go on. That going. Let us go on. Right? Do not be petrified. Do not be afraid of them. And don't converse with fools. Right? So, I didn't even get to it yet. Let us run with endurance. So that easily thing that keeps ensnaring us is called the soul. Satan using it against us. All this goes back to chapter 3 and 4. We've not entered rest. The soul's not resting yet in Christ. And Christ's not resting in us. He's not asleep in the boat. He's still out there in the water. Using both of those imageries. Two different points, but nevertheless. This is all building to these final chapters. What's been laid before in the letter is building towards its ending here. Let us. You're going to see it more and more here. The positive side, let us. Not be like that. But be like those of chapter 11. Be like those. Let us be like those of chapter 11. Let us not be, and earlier in the letter, let us not be like those who didn't enter his rest, right? Let us not be like those who acted that way. Let us not be like those who shrink back. Let us not be, let us not be, let us not be. We're coming toward the end of this letter. Let us go on, and let us now, as we've gone on, hopefully we've entered his rest and are entering his rest. Let us now go on to chapter 11 and see chapter 11 in a whole new light. And how they got there was by faith in the Son of God, or better said, the faith of the Son of God. Now, we're going to be tested and tried right there in a cataclysmic way here at the end. Therefore, let us go on and keep going, and don't stop going, and don't shrink back. For if we shrink back, his heart takes no pleasure in us. So we're either going to please man and people, or we're going to please the Lord here. Right? You're going to be embattled. You understand I'm not talking about just something we're doing. I'm talking about inward right now, where it really matters. If the inward is there, if Christ is in place, if the Spirit of God is gripping us, possessing us, then the outward will come forth. Most of it will be the peace in the midst of the storm. But we don't give much credit to that. We think it's winning an argument. We think it's that thing we do. I'm telling you, it's more inward, and then the expression is more of quietness and peace, quoting the passage of Isaiah. And quietness and peace was your rest, but you would have none of it. Right? Thank you, Madeline. I heard that amen. Let us run with endurance the race that lies before us, keeping our eyes on Jesus. Let's just stop right there. The source and the perfecter of our faith. I like how the Christian Standard Bible properly translates that word, the source. That's the whole battle of the book of Hebrews. In one word, source. Who is it? What is it? Soul or Christ? The Spirit, I said it whenever I said it. When did I say it, Chris? I said it before. The soul and spirit, the spirit is Christ. The soul is not. And it won't be if it's not conquered. He can't even use it. And without that distinction of soul and spirit, without that dividing, let me hit this one more time. Without that dividing of soul and spirit, everything we've known of church is only the soul. If there wasn't a dividing back here, and there wasn't, and if we want to repeat the book of Acts, we're going to have to look way deeper than outward things being done. They weren't there yet either. Keeping your eyes on Jesus. So isn't that the battle? The soul wants you to see everything but Jesus. Focus on everything but Jesus. Isn't that right, Madeline? Let me see your hand back there. Both hands, yeah, me too. I'm not saying that because Madeline needs this. I'm saying it because I know she's in agreement with it. That's why I say she understands, as most of us do right here. I can say it to all of us. Let's see our hands, guys. Do we get it? So we got to keep our eyes on Jesus. Was that a random statement? You bet it's not. It's in view of everything that's been said preceding in this letter. Every deception of the enemy to take our eyes off of the person of Christ, to whom we belong, to whom has taken hold of us. Him who has sacrificed himself for us. Is that not true? Let's just start there in combating the enemy. He has given himself for us. He has taken hold of me, secondly. He is continuing the work, thirdly. And even if I could see nothing and know nothing, even though I do see and know that, I know him enough to know what kind of person he is, and I love him. And I refuse to shrink back. I refuse to listen to the chattering crows, people. If only it was crows, but people chattering. Accusers, deniers, mockers. You're going to face it all. Noah did, we will. And as it was in the nose of Noah, we're going to face mockers. Right? But keeping our eyes on Jesus, if we get our eyes, if our soul can get our eyes on ourselves and what we need, ourselves and what we need to do for Jesus, if we can get our eyes on our gifts, on how God uses us, if we can get our eyes on our meetings and what needs to be going on, if the soul can get us into that realm rather than a higher realm of that which is pleasing to God, whether it's filled with praise or silence, matters not. Neither matters. That the church is not reckoned by its outward manifestations of any kind, but by its inward life of Christ in a people and among a people. What are you doing, Terry? You're shooting down our whole system. You bet I am. That's exactly what I'm doing. I'm telling you that there's Jesus and then there's the church. And like just I said, that should not have been the way, but we're in reality. And I'm not optimistic about it at all because I've read the end of the book. God's going to get a people, including the letter of Hebrews as well as the book of Revelation, God's going to get a people out, not save this system. This system has, he told me this years ago, I didn't begin this system. I'm not upholding it. I'm not funding it. I'm not in it. Don't give your heart to it. And then he said something really dramatic. Shoot it in the head. What? I had to get an explanation on that one, Todd. I better get some more bullets. No, that's not what he's saying. I'm running low on ammo. He said, you present me as the one true head and you'll shoot every other head right in the head. I like that explanation. That's a good explanation. Don't you think, John? Save me some bullets. All right, so keeping your eyes on Jesus is a little bit more than the occasional, but my eyes are on Jesus. Is that true? Or isn't it of me? Is my eyes really there? Is my soul subjected? Is the real answer to that. Because if it isn't, my eyes are not on Jesus. That's just the whole book, the whole letter coming into play up to this passage. We can't lie to our own hearts here. Keeping our eyes on Jesus is not having any other source. Jesus said, did he not, you will never thirst again. Then what in the world are we scurrying around restlessly looking for the next new thing? Needing a new dose, like a drug. A new high, like a drug. Because I'm so low. Sorry, I'm so discouraged. I said this last night and I meant every word of it. The only reason there can be a dark night of the soul is if you're living in it. Living from it. Living unto it. God's attacking your soul, taking away our toys, like he does with children. Then we have a dark night of the soul. But if you're giving up that, you're going to have the light of Christ shining continuously, Madeline. Isn't that something? People make excuses. I'm in the dark night of the soul. If you question them a little deeper, what does that mean? A little deeper, what's that mean? Final answer, I'm not getting what I want. I'm not having what I formerly had. Jesus said something other than that. you'll never thirst again. He said to the woman at the well, if you drink of me, you'll never be thirsty again. What? I will satisfy your hunger. I will satisfy your hunger, but not your soul. Spiritually speaking, though, for a spiritual people, Jesus satisfies. For a soulical people, Jesus doesn't satisfy their soul. Jesus has no plan on satisfying our soul with anything but himself, knowing that the soul can't be satisfied till it's brought in full subjection to the Lord himself. Chris, what do you think about this message? Is it helpful, brother? Helps me. Me too. I need the Lord to be in me greater. That's evident to me. So, just one final thing here. See, this is the thing. Keeping our eyes fixed on Jesus is a specific statement rather than fixed on ourselves. The soul. Self. The soul. Self. The soul, right? It's not a random statement here. It's a specific statement. It's a specific encouragement. If we keep our eyes fixed on Jesus, then we can run the race. If he's our source, we can run the race with endurance because of him in us. And we win by losing our own lives, not by gaining them. Is that not right, Lee? It's absolutely true, isn't it? And it's talking about soulish life, self-life there, by the Christ life. I'm sorry, but just for a moment, don't make it a big deal. Inwardly speaking, I want us to take a measurement. I'm a surveyor. Zechariah chapter 4, there's a surveyor with a measuring rod. And being a surveyor inwardly, I want us to see, because in view of what's being said but to us by the Lord, if the Lord is not measuring the measure of Christ in us right now versus our soul ruling us. No condemnation whatsoever. Just a simple survey. He's after increasing himself in measure. He's after possessing us. Is he not? Should go without saying, it's true. The bride made ready is a possession issue. His life instead of ours. Not soulish Christianity nor church. I personally don't need the soulish things. And I don't want to need them. The Lord satisfies. I have learned, and I am continuing to learn that, and the Lord makes sure by proving that through testing, trials, tribulations of all kinds. There's a source called Christ. He's the perfecter of our faith. If we don't shrink back, though, then our faith is perfected by Christ's possession of us and ruling over our souls. He brings us to that place of where the battle, I'll say it, quoting the scripture, that your victory is in your faith, quoting the scripture. And perhaps, and I know this is true, soulish Christianity has taught us wrongly, given us the wrong definition of faith, and it's become more about believing for the things we need, which is only giving in to the soul rather than trusting in our God, like even to the point of death. And that I can die and still say, I got exactly what I wanted. The Lord. Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego would agree with you. We're not bowing. See, if they bow, that's worship. If they bow, they're worshiping Nebuchadnezzar. But if they don't bow, they're worshiping the Lord, right? Simple, isn't it? So don't bow to your fears. Don't bow to the, you can die in this. Our God, my God, will rescue me. And guys, my rescuing may be other than what I'm thinking. I may be thinking of in the natural, and God the whole time is saying, yeah, I'm going to rescue you. I'm going to bring you home. That can't be the Lord. It has been in untold numbers throughout history. Please don't pray me out of death when it's my time. I will be very upset. You will see my soul in rare display. I'm just joking. Sad to say it, Eugene. Okay, so now let's go to chapter 13, final thing. So therefore, we see, when we come to chapter 13, I hope so much more, but we see the final meaning of what's being said here. Let's just jump in and read a little bit of it. Can't read it all. Remember your leaders. This is verse 7. Who have spoken God's word to you. As you carefully observe the outcome of their lives, imitate their faith. See, that's a chapter 11 issue, right? Those people are presented in chapter 11 saying to us, look what these, they're no different than us, guys. No, they're not super men or women. They just believed in God. That's what any leader should be doing. Isn't that what's being said, Chris? If God has chosen them and God has to choose them, right, Nikki? God has to choose leaders, right? Nikki was sharing some things with me and Deborah, and it's a sad thing, but when man starts choosing leaders, yeah, we're the Titanic sinking, going down fast, right? God only chooses leaders, and there's leaders for a reason. And by the way, you don't want to be a leader for no other reason because of the tempering that's going to go on in you, especially around the realm of the fear of man. Is that not right? Fear of God, Malachi 3, then those who feared the Lord spoke to one another. God took note of it too. Feared the Lord more than they feared what their soul wasn't going to have. More than they feared anything else or anyone else, they feared the Lord. Anyway, remember your leaders who have spoken God's word to you. As you carefully observe the outcome of their lives, imitate their faith. Jesus Christ is the same yesterday, today, and forever. What an overarching last word to say here in what we call chapter 13 about the whole letter of Hebrews. The whole thing is talking to us about this issue. All these people before us found Jesus to be faithful, just like we can and will if we'll simply trust in him. Guys, don't be afraid of your own shadow. Don't be afraid of the voices. Don't be afraid of anyone but the Lord. Fear God. Trust him. People who are not in that path are not going to understand. Don't expect them to understand. And though they're very, very, very vocal, their elevator's not going to the top floor, spiritually speaking. What do you think about that, Francie? Recognize it. Don't say that to them. Call me and I will. No, I'm joking. Spiritually speaking, they don't know what they're talking about. Right? God is trustworthy. The Son of God is in us doing a work. If we're born again and he's begun a good work in us, he knows how to complete it. Wasn't he saying that to us this morning? Don't worry about what you got to do. Just let him in. He's the one who will do the doing. He's the worker in this within, right? He who's begun a good work in you. We're so concerned about this, that, and the other thing. Relax. Enter his rest. Go to sleep in the bottom of the boat with him. Right? Pull his robe over you if you're cold and go to sleep. Might knock off a little bit of the rain, by the way. Just using imagery here. So these ones of chapter 11 and others, they trusted him. We're no different. He was who he was then to them. This is what this passage is saying. And he will be the same to us. That's what's being said in its simplicity. Don't be led astray by various kinds of strange teachings. Have you noticed how people attack you? They want to go to their teachings. What about this? What about that? Right? Argue about the teachings. For it is good for the heart to be established by grace. That's a person named Jesus. And not by food regulations, since those who observe them have not benefited. Did it make them one bit more holy? Let me ask you a question, these people who want to argue about it. Is their soul being brought under the control of the Holy Spirit? These are attacking you. Are their souls under the control of the Holy Spirit? These accusers, is their soul under the control of the Holy Spirit? Then why listen? We have an altar from which those who worship Baal at the tabernacle do not have a right to eat. There's your outward thing, even to the tabernacle. It's of no use either. We're bowing to a person, not a structure, not an organization, not a way of doing church, not teachings, not doctrines. We are bowing only to the person of Jesus Christ, his Father, and the Spirit of God. Their plan, their will, their way, their desire, only. Amen. Right? That's right, isn't it, Minnie? Isn't it right? For the bodies of those animals whose blood is brought into the most holy place by the high priest as a sin offering are burned outside the camp. In other words, freeing them from sin. But for us, not animals. Therefore, Jesus himself also suffered outside the gate. I told you, the Lord came and repudiated the whole old covenant by bringing it into himself and saying, I am seven times. At least that's what's recorded in the scriptures. I think more than that. He brought it all to himself. Said to them specifically, to those who were stuck in Judaism, unless you believe, here it is in the Greek, ego a me, ego being I in the Greek, a me being I am. Unless you believe that I am the I am, he is calling himself Yahweh, who spoke to Moses. Unless you believe that I am the I am he, you will die in your sins. You are in a soulless religion and you will not get free. Therefore, Hebrews 6, though you've tasted of the good things of God in that way, that outward way, though you've experienced what you've experienced in that outward way, yet you are falling away from me, the person. You won't come to me. Then do you see the great falling away clearly? It's away from the person. It's not away from the church system. It's not away from the nonsense of the soul that's a falling away. It's this, it's this apostatizing. It's this rejection of the person as our all in all, as our salvation. We have fallen away already if we're not trusting him. Come back to trusting. He who began a good work in you will complete it. But do not expect for your soul's desire to be met in any other way but by the person. He's not coming to give us heaven on earth in an outward way. He's bringing the life of God, the Godhead, Christ's life in, and it's an internal kingdom and an eternal kingdom. Heaven within. Amen. What is our expectations? God fix this, God fix that. He may or may not. It's immaterial. If the more I need it to be fixed, if I'm going to believe, the more he's going to resist me in doing it. Because he doesn't want me on that ground. That's not the ground of Christ. And he was calling to those people back then to come off of that ground and believe in me. I am the I am. You guys have waited for 4,000 years for me to come. And look what you're doing to me. Your father Abraham saw me from a distance. And you guys are wanting to murder me. He believed in me back then. Moses believed in me, who you speak so highly of. Enoch believed in me. Adam and Eve knew me and believed in me. Abel believed in me. See what Jesus is saying to them? But you guys have got your soulish things and you've already fallen away from me. And I'm trying to draw you back. Hear me, church. He's trying to draw us back to himself. But we are stuck like the Jews in this soulish system, loving it, feeding on it, enjoying it, craving it, and all the rest of the stuff that is pure nonsense to God. But it's worse than that. It is rebellion to Christ. And it is a sin against the Holy Spirit who's declaring that Christ. And we're denying the Holy Spirit's testimony and the testimony of his servants, of his messengers, who are calling us up out of the nonsense of our own souls first, and then collectively our souls as a church and as the church. Amen. I don't want to end on that note. Just let me end on this note. We're all doomed. No. No. That's not the message ending. Let us go on, or it will be. Amen. There's the injunction. Can God have a restart amongst us right here? And anybody listening, can he have a restart? Can he maybe have something within that's conquering the soul now? Right? We'll have to go outside this present camp with him if that's going to happen. Isn't that right? That's the message here. Jesus suffered outside the gate so that he might sanctify the people by his own blood. Let us then go with him outside the camp. What's being spoken of here? Jerusalem. That's what. The city of God, whom Jesus wept over and prophesied against. And now us. The church, I mean. Now us. My brothers, my sisters, my friends, neighbors, lend me your ears. Not really. Let us hear what the Spirit is saying to the church. The Holy One. By refiner's fire, by launderer's soap, cleansing away even the rubble of the former thing within us, that he may establish for himself what's said in Numbers chapter 3 concerning the Levites, but quoting Malachi 3 as well, they shall serve me. If that's not a bridal passage, I've never read one. They shall be with me, serving me in all my work. Now that's a bridal passage. He's talking about Aaron, the high priest, who he gave the Levites to. But that's a picture of Christ and his bride. Jesus said, as we know, we see it in Malachi 3, but it was first in Numbers 3. The Levites shall be mine. I believe the Lord would invite us out of the city. Don't you think? Out of those gates that are not the Psalm 24 right gate. Lift up your heads, O ye gates, be lifted up, O ancient, right? Ancient doors, the King of Glory may come in.
Who is the King of Glory?
Who is he, sweetie?
The Lord strong and mighty.
Amen. Right answer. Amen. Did you ever blow the shofar, brother? Never did. Do you want to? No. I met someone in Phoenix one time that looked a lot like you. Did your angel ever leave you and go to Phoenix? No. What a question, huh? Blow the shofar and the witch ran out the back? Seriously. That was back in the back part of the building calling me a false prophet. And the ushers were doing nothing. Whatever. Jesus can stir up things. You know that, guys? Will we go with him? Can I go with him out of my soul, out of soulish Christianity, out of soulish church, out of soulish ministry, out of soulish actions personally, soulish reactions, and get out to the Lord? Can the soul then be brought into its proper place to where Christ alone is seen? Not the people, not the vessel, Christ. Can that even be? Can there be a bride who by that definition, Satan has nothing in her? And to see her is to behold the Lord. Is that what we want? Are we willing now to allow the Lord to give us a different vision, a different view, his, a different concept and a different understanding of what it is to belong to him? Of what it is to be the Levites with him in his work, given to him, to his work, not ours, his, the high priest. Are we willing to let him redefine by refiner's fire and launderer's soap and purify the sons and daughters of Levi? Are we willing to be those who feared the Lord from what we just heard and other things we have been hearing? Those who fear the Lord. And when we speak to one another, it be there rather than placating one another's soul. And that God takes note of that kind of conversations. And he has something to say to us like he did there in Numbers 3 and Malachi 3. They will be mine. They're my Levites. They are with me in my great eternal, universal work. and I shall protect them. They're a treasure to me, and I shall protect them as a father protects his own son. Malachi 3. And if that's what we want, I want us to stand up. I pray that as you stand up, that this dreadful soul sickness, okay, dreadful soul sickness coming from an independent spirit in us that wants our soul to be getting what it wants, that we can get healed and delivered, healed in our hearts from wounds that should have never been a wound, because the wound came when our soul didn't get what it wanted. And we were wounded by such things and shouldn't have been, but we are. And may the Lord now, as we're standing and declaring inwardly back to him, heal me of my disappointments and my discouragement, because my soul is being tried and I'm giving in to its disappointment and I'm giving in to its fears. Let me just describe what's going on. If you're discouraged, you're discouraged because of your soul. There's no other reason. And the Lord's not going to just placate our soul. He wants to heal it and deliver it, or we're going to be there again. So we can, you know what? We can band-aid it, or we can let the Lord really be something in us. Absolutely transforming. How many want the transformation? You see your hand. The Lord sees. Now, Lord, you see our hands. Keep them up there for a moment. You see our hands. We want deliverance. We want transformation to the image of Christ, and so that the soul does not have its power in us anymore. It does not rule us in any way, especially though, Lord, in religious ways, to where its cravings and its desires and its hungers and its thirstings are not given into, and instead, Jesus satisfies our hungers. Jesus quenches our thirst. Jesus, Jesus, Jesus. And I will fight right there in the name that's above every name, the I am that he is. Come what may, people say what they say. Jesus has begun a good work in me. Jesus gave himself for us. Jesus is continuing the work in me. And Jesus will finish the work in me. There we stand. That's our 95 theses tacked to the door of Edinburgh, there in Edinburgh. Jesus. Thank you, Lord. I have one answer, Jesus. One I am, Jesus. One all-knowing one, all-knowing one, Jesus, not me. And I'm not rivaling him as if that were even possible. It's Jesus the I am. Jesus the way, Jesus the truth. Jesus the life. Heal us now in the wounds of our soul. Get us out of the dark night of the soul that we should have never been in that hole. Bring us up and out of it. There's a resurrection life that has nothing to do with the dark night of the soul. The crushing of the soul is not where we live and remain. Let it be over quickly. And by coming, let's say it, him coming in as the resurrection and the life. Amen. Amen. I mean it. Lord, heal us right now, all of us, and all is going to listen. And I pray people will spread this everywhere, not because I said it, because there's so many who's in the dark night of the soul and has read this religious understanding, soulish understanding, and they get in it and can't get out of it, and they go through it regularly, and all because of a lie, a lie, a lie. Greater is he that's within you than he that's within the world. Your soul is not your life. Christ is. no testimony in restlessness. There's testimony in rest. Isn't that right, Andy? I have come to rest. I'm not looking for anything else. There is no new thing. There's Jesus, the eternal one. Amen. That's just a simple proclamation, declaration, don't you think, Mike, that absolutely needs to be made? And the reality of it, though, will bring down principalities that are now residing in the house of God. That's the truth. The soul comes down and the principalities come down with it. Christ arises and they're toast. Amen. So let Christ arise in us, people of God, not our flesh and not our soul. Inwardly speaking, because this thing's meant to be lived out there, not about a meeting expression, but about an expression out there. Is that not right? Show it to me out there. And if it's eternal, it'll be seen out there, and its effect called life will be registered against the enemy. Is that not right? Forget about all this meeting-based Christianity's nonsense. It's about what's expressed out there. Is that not right? It's right, isn't it, Todd? It's lived out there. It's expressed out there. And if it's of no use out there, why is it of any use in here? Amen. Give me Jesus. They said it in our beginning of our nation. Give me liberty or give me death. Well, give me Jesus. Give me Jesus. The Greeks came and said, sir, we would see Jesus. Right? Give me Jesus. I'm asking again, Lord, arise as the healer of our souls, as the deliverer of our souls, freeing us from its power. I'm asking for a beginning right now. An ending will come, but a beginning, a conquering beginning to begin right now in us. To rewire us away from the soul's mind, so from the soul's will, and from the emotions of the soul, to come, and according to Hebrews chapter 4, you can do it, and divide soul and spirit, as you can divide the bone and marrow. Is that not right? Divide in me, divide in us, divide, and show yourself again. Reveal yourself. I'm asking for the faith of the Son of God in us. That is a conquering faith that he himself is greater than what we're going to face. Just as I was talking about it, praying about it earlier. He is greater than the shaking. You're unshakable if he has you. If your soul is being conquered, you cannot be shaken. You see the fight then. Let the soul be conquered. Right? Let the soul be conquered and you won't be shaken. If I don't allow the soul to be conquered, if we don't allow it corporately, we will be shaken. Let our minds, the mind of the soul, be conquered. Let the will of the soul be conquered. Let the emotions of the soul be conquered. Fix our eyes not upon those things, though, but upon Jesus. Get them off of ourselves. I need to. That self. Look at me, look at me, look at me. That self, that soul. And back on to Jesus and keep them there. And the Holy Spirit will help us, he'll have to keep them there. Restore that vision of the Christ, of the Son of the living God to your people, to the church of Jesus Christ. All the way out. Don't get to the gate and stop. Go through the gate, outside the camp, all the way to Calvary. Can you hear that? All the way to Calvary. No matter what has gone on thus far, isn't that right, Josh? All the way to Calvary. All the way to the cross. And I no longer live. My soul is no longer in charge. Christ in me is my government. Amen. Heal us. I ask God plainly right now to show us why our souls have been so scarred, so wounded, so hurt. And it's because we live from them and in them. And if that were not the case, we wouldn't be so cut up, so fragmented, so disjointed and out of joint. And the body wouldn't look like it's got an arm growing out of its ear. Leg coming out of its mouth or foot first. It's too good to pass up, Lee. Always sticking my foot in my mouth. Now it's growing a leg. Heal us, Lord. Just stand here for a second. The Lord revealing. We've been trying to get the Lord to put a Band-Aid on our souls. He wants to save it instead. From itself. By Him being the Savior. Living in our spirit, joined to our spirit, conquering our soul. Making it a useful instrument for which He gave the soul to us. Eternally so. It's not going away. The soul will have great use to God when it's conquered and expressing Him in the age of ages to come. But not unconquered. So, Lord, heal. So I'm going to actually dismiss everyone who wants to go. And I'm asking for everyone who wants healing, not for the soul now, but for your body physically. If you want healing, and ask God for healing. I want to lay hands on you. I'm not doing this. It's not going to be long. I want to obey what was given to me some months back in direct encounter with the Lord, and the Lord Himself telling me, give me your hands, Terry. I didn't even know this. The Lord, you may have heard me tell the story. He was sitting at a table. I did not even recognize Him. He was in a different form. Someone was in front of me. I waited till they left. I was right behind them. I sat down across from Him at the table, not knowing who He was. I'm saying this. The only reason I'm saying this is not to get our eyes on the experience. It has nothing to do with why I'm saying it. I'm saying it so that we can believe and have expectation and what the Lord wants to do in healing our bodies. That's why I'm saying it. It is not random what I'm doing. It is obedience for me. He took my hands. That's when I recognized Him, when He put His hands out and said, give me your hands. And I saw the marks in His wrists. And He quoted Acts 4:33 and Acts 5:12 directly to me. Trust me in this, He said, Terry. And see what happens. That's why I'm going to lay hands. It's going to be brief. It's not me. Either the Lord does what He does or He doesn't. You're not healed unless we're healed. There's not a faith for healing. I'm healed by faith. No, you're not. You're either healed or you're not. Faith doesn't heal anybody. Jesus does. Now, if He says He's going to heal you, amen. But be aware that it could be that He's going to take you home. So if you need healing, and the rest of you guys feel free. You don't have to be quiet and all that stuff. You can be as loud as you want to. It's not going to interfere with anything. I mean, don't yell and scream or anything. But if you need healing in your body, I want you to come down. I'm going to lay hands on you. Now, as you're coming, be aware that as I lay hands on you, I'm going to have to spit in your eye. Now, get some mud. Spit on the mud, rub that in your... I'm only joking. All right. Now, if I told y'all I had a dreaded disease in my hands, would you still come forward? No. All right.
right.
Rest of you guys, if you got to go, please do. Please feel free. Looks like everybody's here pretty much. You ain't going nowhere. Neither am I. So I'm going to be really quick, okay? I'm not going to put it on your forehead. I'm going to both hands right on your neck, okay? So get your hair out of the way. You bald guys don't have to worry about anything. All right. Where do I start?